So first of all, the title, of course, is should be rather enigmatic for most people. So my first goal is to try to explain a little bit what it means. Sometimes I'll just read what is on the screen, because I personally find it confusing when there are some words on the screen and then the speaker pronounces something about the same thing but in different words. That makes me personally confused. So I'll read from it. So I'll start with a few words about the title. Neither of the two concepts that it is composed of, a meta theory and dependent type series, has a precise mathematical definition. What it is supposed to mean is that the talk will be about the mathematical theory. What ideally it is supposed to be to mean is that the talk will be about the mathematical theory of mathematical objects that are called dependent type series. Unfortunately, or maybe fortunately to those of us who find the mathematics of dependent type series fascinating, we don't have a mathematical definition of a class of objects that we would agree to call dependent type series. So I started learning what is known about dependent type series around 2004, 2005. And the only book about what they are that I could read at that time was by Bart Jacob, called Categorical Logic and Type Theory. So the book has 778 pages. And the first attempt to introduce dependent type theories is made somewhere very close to the end of the book. So it's basically almost the end of the book. I actually read all the definitions and constructions, not the proofs, that were needed to understand what Bart Jacob was saying in his chapter on dependent or dependent polymorphic type series. It took me about a year. But I was able to understand what this guy is saying. So then there were lots of other papers which I couldn't understand at all. And then slowly I learned how to read the text on type theory written by computer scientists and logicians. So there are rules, and the first and most important rule is that you should never try to figure out how to prove this or that statement. Once you learn to just trust your intuition, that is, believe in everything that the established leaders have stated without a proof or precise definition in their early papers, then it was possible to understand what people in the field were talking about. I came from a field of algebraic geometry of motives where we really prove things rather pedantically and where the standard is the gross indic SGA and EGA. So my first contact with papers written in this style was just complete kind of I was completely confused. On the side of computer scientists, this approach to concepts and results had a certain foundation. They actually created programming languages and wrote programs using these results and concepts as the guiding principles, and they worked. So computer scientists were saying, I don't want to prove this. But using this conclusion, I can build this program, and this program works. For me, it's sufficient. And there is a certain merit in such an approach. And if programs based on somebody's ideas have been working for 30 years and with many users, then these ideas must be correct. So this is the so that's how the a very large mass of papers in this field is organized. And this didn't however didn't satisfy me. I had some very beautiful ideas about how to use the dependent type theories to construct a formal system for mathematics that would incorporate in its very structure the fundamental idea of Cantor, Bourbaki, and later the architects of higher dimensional mathematics, that mathematically meaningful statements must be invariant under bijection isomorphism and their high dimensional extensions. So we learned somehow I wouldn't even call it as a meta principle, but just as a principle of thinking that one should not ever consider statements which are not invariant under the equivalence of the appropriate objects. And suddenly there was this opening to create a language where it will be really impossible to write a statement which is not invariant. So this invariance, which goes back to the idea of bijections by Cantor, becomes incorporated in the logical structure of the language. And that was very exciting and very beautiful. And I really wanted to bring it to the mathematical community and to say, look what kind of beautiful thing I have found. But however, the ideas were unusual and went against the common wisdom in several places. And I needed to have mathematically rigorous construction of the translation from the new language that I was devising into the accepted formal language of Sturmela-Frankel theory with the axiom of choice. So I need to have an interpretation, and I need to construct it. I had to construct it rigorously, so that I can say, look, okay, it looks weird, but here is the proof that it's right. I also needed mathematically rigorous proofs that this translation will translate the main concept of mathematics, which I was going to define in the new language, into their counterparts in ZFC. So one needs not just a translation, but a translation which maps the basic concept into basic concept. So the proofs themselves will have to be done in the ZFC so that they will be accepted by mathematical communities as being valid. And so first I needed a mathematically rigorous definition of this new language, or better, formal deduction system, because it also included the rules of how to construct proofs in it. So there is this gadget, this formal deduction system, and I needed to assign to it a mathematical object of some sort. And so this is basically what the meta theory of dependent type theories is about. So the theory, the system which I was building, in its practical manifestation, that is based on the structure of the computer programs that will have to be written to work with it in a computer-assisted environment, was clearly dependent type theory. So I was inventing a new language, but it clearly could be classified as a dependent type theory, despite the fact that we don't have a definition of what a dependent type theory is. However, I wasn't sure about the exact structure of the system, and foresaw that it may take many years or maybe decades to choose one or a few variants that will be most convenient for writing mathematics. So it was clear that the idea which I had allows to construct many formal deduction systems. And and I needed to be able to prove or to construct a translation for all of them, not just for one system. I couldn't take one system and just work out the details for this one system. I needed something which would include some abstract definition, and then I would take a particular cases of it. So therefore, I needed a ZFC rigorous definition of a dependent type theory, and ZFC proven theorems about interpretations of particular type theories into systems such as ZFC itself. So what Jacob was suggesting in his book did not satisfy me. It was clear that one of the reasons why it was at the end of the book is because he didn't know how to go any further. And indeed, it was it was not clear how to use that. So in 2005, I came to the conclusion that I had to build a mathematical theory of dependent type theories. So it was not a new subject. Now, there is an important picture to keep in mind. And depending on how one traces the history, one can go at least as far as the PhD thesis of John Cartmell in 1978, which we'll come back to later, and easily as far back as the 1847 mathematical analysis of logic by George Boole. So it was a very established subject. Even if we start with Cartmell, and it makes a lot of sense to start with him, we are looking at a subject that has been in developing for nearly 40 years. During this period, there were many very interesting and original ideas, and a lot of hard technical work done. However, especially where the ideas of logic and computer science had to be joined, there were also major gaps. Not only simple gaps, but places where the approaching lines from the computer science and mathematics turned away from each other before they actually met, and we're getting further and further apart. So while they were, in some sense, pretending more and more that they're talking about the same thing, but in reality, they were moving further and further apart. So in 2005, I started working on a new mathematical theory of type theories, or meta-theory of type theories, if you want, starting from the closest points that the two lines have reached. So that meant that very little, and in the event almost none, of the recent work could be used. So I had to discard a lot of what, most of what people have done in the last 40 years. And start from the points which where the theory was 40 years ago. That was, of course, a lot of trouble because it meant that I'm not citing any papers of the people who are still alive, and that was not looked at with sympathy. So I'm still working on this theory. So I reached two major breakthroughs in 2009 and wrote very incomplete notes called Notes on Type Theory. They contained the description of the main structural features of the theory as I was that I was aiming at. And I think we'll have time for me to draw a couple of pictures that that will give some idea after I introduce one mathematical definition. So I'm still working on it, and I'm slowly succeeding. So one of my great success was that the paper that I was one of the most important constructions needed for the translation of my language into ZFC. I submitted it to Publicación IHS. They wrote back to me that they don't accept papers in logic. I said that I claim it's not logic, but algebra and category theory. And so they accepted it for refereeing, and I received a rather sympathetic referee report. So to me, it's recognition of the fact that what I'm doing is actually mathematics. And that's an important for me. It's kind of one of the most important points to make that this weird stuff is really mathematics. It's just a little unusual. On the other hand, more and more people from computer science and logic agree with me now that some of the fundamental facts that they took for granted need proofs. Some of them started working on it, but I think most of them still wait for me to do it. But it's accepted that what at first sounded like a crazy idea, because obviously everyone knows that this is true. Now today it's accepted by some, not by all, that indeed there is a gap, and that nobody knows how to fill the gap. In fact, in the particular place which I have in mind, this gap was filled in 1983 in one particular case, in a very simple particular case, and a very special particular case by a mathematician and logician, Thomas Stryker. And it was his PhD thesis, and then he published it, and it was a book. It was like, I don't know how many, 300 pages. So. The actual proof of this little statement in a very particular special case took him 300 pages, and I haven't seen any other proofs of it appearing since. It's a very strange community from my point of view. Let me make now a small digression. So that was all about the meta theory of dependent type theories and what they are and what they are not yet, and why I'm interested in it. So let me make a small digression. In parallel to my work on mathematical theory of type theories, I also worked on my new language for writing mathematics. So it turned out almost miraculously that I can build a working prototype of this language as a sub-language of the language of proof assistant Koch. So there is something called proof assistant Koch, which has been in development for like 30 years. It has a very big user base. It's an established proof assistant. And I found a way to embed my language soundly, as one probably should say, or faithfully into the language of Koch. So I decided to, I didn't know how much of Koch's rather baroque language I will actually need, and I decided to try to determine what is the smallest subset. The only way to determine it was by actually doing formalization. So taking a piece of mathematics, actually writing it in this language, and seeing how much or how little I can use. So I decided to choose the smallest subset that I could work with. The only way to find out what I needed was to start writing a library of mathematics in my new language using Koch. So I started this work in the spring of 2010. It was fun. It was really a pleasant way of doing mathematics. And there were surprises, one of which led to a major new line of development in the field, the cubical type theory. So the particular surprise which I have in mind is that is that the univalence axiom implies function extensionality. That's what got Thierry Coquand on board, and he became very excited, and eventually came up with the cubical type theory. In 2011, I had a library with all of the main structural definitions and theorems of the kind of foundation and the application to the construction of the number systems up to the rational numbers following the Bourbaki approach. So I decided that will be my test. Can I construct a Q following the Bourbaki approach? So I would say define what are monoids, what are groups, what are rings, what are semi-rings, what are fields. Then I will define what is a group of differences of a commutative monoid. Then I will define what is a ring of differences of a rig. Its rig is a kind of a semi-ring with an additional axiom. Then I'll define what is a localization of a commutative ring by an ideal, and in particular, what is the ring of a field of fractions over integral domain. So I started doing, and then I would apply to natural numbers. Natural numbers are internal in Coq. And I want to get from that rational numbers about which will be the correct rational numbers. So I did it, and it didn't take me very long. In fact, I did more. I also introduced the notion of relations, kind of lesser equal or greater equal relations, compatible with the algebraic structure on each of the levels, and showed how to descend it through the levels. So, for example, if I have an ordering on a ring and I have an ideal with some properties, then how can I define an ordering of the corresponding localization of the ring? So I added all of these things which were not in Bourbaki, which gave me the standard orders on rational numbers and their compatibility with multiplication and addition as a consequence of general theorems about abstract objects. So after that, it was clear to me, after having this experience, that all of the set theoretic mathematics can be conveniently and isomorphism invariantly written in this language. And that by that time, what I was developing started to deserve the name of a foundation of mathematics, or of a class of foundations of mathematics. It became called univalent foundations, UF for short. Later, the particular foundation that uses the language that I embedded into Coq, which is kind of a minimalistic version of the language, became known as UniMath. So UniMath is a concrete foundation, concrete univalent foundation based on this language embedded into Coq, but the language of UniMath can also be embedded into different in the languages of different proof assistants in principle. So what I did all applied only to set level mathematics. The subsequent work by Benedict Arends, who was a member here twice, I think, Chris Kapulkin, who was also a member here once, and Michael Schulman, who was also a member here once, proved that we can also conveniently formalize in the UniMath category level mathematics. And when you start formalizing category level mathematics, there are again some surprises, which are very very interesting, and I will say a couple of words. I will say a couple of words later about it, about the surprises. Or maybe I can say one word now. The problem is that a category, as it's defined in ZFC, is an algebraic object. Well, it's semi-algebraic, but essentially algebraic. Semi-algebraic, because operations are not everywhere defined. So for such objects, there is a natural notion of equivalence. And this notion of equivalence is the notion of isomorphism. However, for categories, we also So everything, if I just formalize the definition from ZFC, then I have a guarantee that everything that I can say in UniMath about a category will be invariant under an isomorphism, under isomorphisms of categories. But we want to have invariance under equivalence of categories, so that somehow it should have appeared from somewhere. And indeed, it does appear. In UniMath, in fact, there are kind of two classes of objects. There are pre-categories, and then there are, sometimes we call them either just categories or univalent categories, which form a subset of subclass of all pre-categories. And for this subclass, isomorphisms are the same as equivalences. This is a little complicated, but so any category has a can be projected into the class of univalent categories. So this inclusion of univalent categories into all categories has a kind of left adjoint. And this left adjoint was called rest completion. And it turns any category into weakly equivalent to it, category univalent, for which everything is invariant under equivalences. So these questions about the difference between invariance under isomorphism and invariance under equivalence, we'll see that they come up very, very, it's very important questions on the literally almost the first step of mathematical theory of type series, and of meta theory of type series, of ZFC meta theory of type series. And the fact that in UniMath they can be studied in this internal way opens up, creates a lot of new mathematics, which actually tells us something in the form of actual theorems, which in the ZFC foundations we can only talk about as some philosophical principles. So some of the philosophical principles become actual theorems or definitions. So Unimath contains now sufficient amount of basic mathematics for other people to start formalizing their research work in some directions. In particular, a lot of work on the mathematical theory of type series is now formalized in the Unimath. Now, here I need to explain why we bother doing it, because for proving the consistency, for proving the correctness of this new language, we need to do our proofs in ZFC. I mean, it's meaningless to do a proofs about a system, about consistency of a system inside the system itself. I mean, if it's inconsistent, then of course you'll have a proof. So it looks at first as a strange exercise, but it actually isn't. So while it is necessary to formalize the proofs related to the translation of the Unimath into ZFC in the ZFC, in order to use this formalization as a certificate of correctness modulo the consistency of ZFC, formalizing it in the Unimath is both interesting and satisfying, because it requires the arguments to be spelled out in a lot of detail and will certainly make work on the formalization in the ZFC much easier. Even despite the fact that these two systems are different in many important points. So that was one digression that I wanted to say about Unimath, and to say that a lot of the work which about the mathematical theory of type series is now being formalized in the Unimath. And this formalization is not something which I do. It's something which the next generation, so to speak, does. And it was, to some extent, their initiative also. So I also want to make another very important point here. Sometimes people start arguments about what is better, ZFC or Unimath. So I claim that these arguments are comparing apples with oranges. Unimath should be considered in the line of foundations of constructive mathematics. Then it becomes obvious what is its position. And one may start kind of productive arguments about the questions that arise in the discussions of constructive foundations. So it should not be, it should be included in this line of constructive mathematics. At the same time, Unimath is probably the first constructive foundation where the law of excluded middle and the axiom of choice can be formulated in a non-trivial way. And this leads to the possibility to develop a foundation for classical mathematics inside the Unimath.
So can you clarify this axiom of choice issue? Is this part of you need it?
No. So far, Unimath is fully constructive. We don't use either excluded middle or axiom of choice. However, we know that certain theorems which people like, the certain simplifications arise if we assume in addition excluded middle and axiom of choice. So what I'm saying is that we or somebody else can start developing this work on classical mathematics inside the Unimath using already everything that has been done constructively in the Unimath. So we don't use axiom of choice.
And can you clarify what you mean in a non-trivial way?
No. Sorry, Avi. It would lead us very far.
But it's important. I mean, if there was a trivial way to formulate it, would it be well?
Yes, there is a trivial way to formulate it in type theory, which leads to kind of nonsense theory. And so that was considered a proof to that in type theory one cannot formalize classical mathematics. In the UniMath, we have new ideas which allow to formulate the axiom of choice and the law of excluded middle differently than they were originally formulated. And this new formulations lead to a very intuitive and kind of correct, in quotes, embedding of classical mathematics into type theory. So at the same time, UniMath is probably the first constructive foundations where the law of excluded middle and the axiom of choice can be formulated in a non-trivial way. So this leads to the possibility to develop a foundation for classical mathematics inside the UniMath by considering classical statements and proofs as the UniMath statements that have the law of excluded middle and the axiom of choice as two additional assumptions. The foundation of classical mathematics that one obtains in this manner is probably not as convenient as ZFC, and probably a little weaker, although I couldn't quite come up with an isomorphism invariant statement which would be provable in ZFC and not in UniMath. That is, fewer statements can be proved without additional axioms. However, this foundation is bijection isomorphism invariant, and it is naturally a subset of foundation of constructive mathematics, that is, those proofs that are essentially algorithms can be formalized without the loss of their algorithmic structure. And finally, it has a much more convenient implementation in the form of the computer proof assistants than the known to me implementations of ZFC. But that, of course, may change. So we haven't explored these questions much because the UniMath library is constructive. Neither the law of excluded middle nor the axiom of choice are used as an assumption of any of its theorems. So this is the answer to. So let me now try to describe the structure of the mathematical theory of type theories that I, or as now would be more correct to say we, are aiming at. And the central position there is occupied by objects called C-systems that were originally introduced and studied by John Cartmell in his PhD thesis in 1978 under the name contextual category. So that's how far back I had to go. So here's how mathematics starts. And first, it's a rather obvious mathematics, but by pre-category, we mean a pair of sets, more C and OP C, with four maps, as usual. Domain, codomain, identity, and composition, which satisfies the well-known conditions of unity and associativity. Note that we write composition of morphisms in the form FG or F circle G, where F is from X to Y and G is from Y to Z. So this is called the diagrammatic order, and I have been using it now for many in my papers, in all of my papers, and I should say that it's much more convenient. If one needs to read a diagram into the equation, then this reversal of direction of composition is a nightmare, and especially if you start also thinking about non-strict associativity of composition in some cases, then it gets even worse. So I very much advertised this diagrammatic order. So this object would be usually called categories unless we want to emphasize that that we are going to use this structure, this object, in a way that is not invariant under equivalences, equivalences of categories. In this case, we will, I don't know what's written here, but in that case, we will call them pre-categories. Pre-category category is the same thing, just in a different context. In ZFC, in UniMath, this is a different thing. So here is the definition of a C system. So it's C system is a pre-category CC with additional structure of the form. So the first component is a length function. It's a function from objects, not isomorphism classes of objects, but objects of CC into natural numbers. There is a unique object of length zero. Now there is fixed a map from objects to objects, again not isomorphism classes, such that if the length of x is greater than zero, then length of the ft of x is the length of x minus one, and the ft of the point is the point. For each x, there is fixed a morphism from x to ftx. So it means that actually for any x, if L of x is n, then I have a tower and here will be FTL of x, which will be equal to the point. Yes, here n. Thank you. So for each x whose length is such that L of x is greater than zero, and each morphism from y to ft of x. So I need some more space. So I'll this should be clear by well, I can try. So if I have an x of length greater than zero, then I have ft of x, which is different from x, because it has length one less, and I have this morphism px. Now, for any f from y to px, there is fixed an object called f upper star of x, and the morphism called q fx. Such that the following additional conditions are satisfied. So this unique object of length zero is the final object. The pt of the ft of f star of x equals y. So that's an axiom. By the way, it includes equality of objects. Right, so the ft of this object equals this object. It equals. So here I have p f upper star of x because of this relation, and I get a square. And the axiom says that the square is a pullback square. And now one has two further axioms about the behavior of qfx. One says that q of the identity equals identity. And another one says that Q of composition, GF, is equal to the composition of two Qs. For a slightly different definition, C4, it's at the end of the slides, and the slides will be posted. So you will be able to follow the links if need be. Now, it's not very surprising, probably, that this definition didn't immediately take off. In fact, I think this in fact, I guess it was so bad that then John Cartmell left academia and went into the industry, and he is now in the industry. And I found him about 2 years ago. He was very surprised that somebody found him, and I invited him to a workshop where the systems were considered, and he came, and it was interesting. So. It was not an immediately successful concept. However, what turns out more and more is that it is the right concept for an important function in mathematical theory of type theories. And one can both construct a lot of these systems and prove a lot of theorems about these systems. By combining the two, one can get a lot of theorems about a lot of things. It does not so far directly touch any of the. It doesn't touch like algebraic geometry, for example. I don't know where it would. But who knows? It certainly touches the theory of infinity categories. So maybe I should actually spend my last 5 minutes on, instead of advertising my papers on these systems, on saying something a little different. So my papers can be easily found through the internet. There is another direction which I'm not pursuing, because I'm interested in the connection between C systems and actual syntax. So for me, the main gap which I want to fill is is about certain categorical properties of C system constructed from syntax, kind of physical syntax satisfying certain properties. So I'm working very close to the syntactic side. So these guys are much more interested in kind of to get as far away from syntax as possible. And any syntax defines a C system. Any raw syntax with variables defines with free and bound variables also defines a C system. Subsystems of this C system are the syntactic C systems of type series. Actually, subquotients, because they also input impose certain equivalence relations on the expressions. And now, type theories have also inference rules, and inference rules reflect themselves as partially defined operations on C systems. So one good thing about C systems is when you see an inference rule written into this shorthand of computer scientists, you can actually describe easily a corresponding what kind of operation on C systems corresponds to this inference rule. So systems of inference rules, where one has inference rules which depend on each other, which is typical thing in type theory, correspond to systems of operations on C systems. So to purely algebraic gadget. There are kind of three main systems of inference rules: the pi system, the sigma systems as system, and the identity type system. And these guys, they consider C systems with these operations corresponding to these three sorts of inference rules. And then they consider a model structure on the C system, model structure as in homotopy theory. And no, wait, it's not a model structure. How does it work? No, they make a simplicial category out of a C system using these operations. Chris Kapulkin, one of the people working in that direction, in his PhD thesis, he has proved that and eventually one constructs a simplicial set out of a system with operations. So he proved that the simplicial sets are quasi-categories, and moreover, that they're locally Cartesian closed quasi-categories. And right now they're working in the direction of constructing a Quillen model structure on the category of these systems with these operations, and proving that the homotopy category of that closed model structure is equivalent to the homotopy category of the locally Cartesian of locally Cartesianly closed infinity categories. So there is a lot of connection with infinity categories crowd, which is kind of the idea is a little bit further away from syntax and to analyze what is on the other side. So C systems, they're in the middle. So one starts with the type theory, which is described in some terms familiar to a computer scientist. It's a living object. It's something which is actually programmed in C or I don't know, in OCaml. From this gadget, one defines a C system with additional operations. So on the other hand, one starts with a category of something like, I don't know, simplicial sets or some other abstract mathematical objects, which don't have any physical existence, and from simplicial sets, or from such a category with some additional structure, one also builds a C system with operations of this similar form. Right. So this is usually rather easy. This is called constructing a model of this inference rules on this category. That's the meaning of the word model. So the C system is a model of the type theory. And we have also another C system, which is built from syntax. And there is a conjecture which says that this C system, with its operations, is the initial object in the category of all such C systems with these operations. And so every time that one can construct these two things, one has a homomorphism. And a homomorphism allows one to interpret the sentences of the type theory as mathematical objects. And so in particular, one can apply it in the case of unimass, for example. Unimass is a particular type theory. There is a C system with operations corresponding to it, syntactic one. And then there is a construction of a C system with similar operations from Kant's implicial set, which is something which was one of these two major breakthroughs of 2009, which I have done. And then if the initiality conjecture holds, we have a homomorphism. And we know this homomorphism, in fact, easy to interpret intuitively as it corresponds to the translation, should correspond if it exists, to the translation. Intuitive translation of the unimass language into the language of ZFC, for example, because this is this part. I mean, this whole thing should be done in ZFC, to as a meta theory, so that and the existence of this category of sets with the required properties is a consequence of the consistency of ZFC. So the consistency of ZFC is assumed here. And but anyway, we have this initiality conjecture.
What do you mean the consistency of ZFC is assumed? Then it's not a proof of classical mathematics, because we don't assume that.
Hmm?
What do you mean the proof of the consistency of ZFC is assumed? That would be an additional axiom that one normally doesn't assume.
Of course one assumes it. Every time one uses ZFC to prove something, one assumes its consistency, because if it's... Well, but that is just a manner of expressing oneself. In fact, it is an assumption in so, but here is this initiality conjecture, which for me is a central thing, and this is what I'm working on. So I'm working on the one hand to describe the objects which appear here in the case of univalent foundation, unimass, for example. So to describe concretely this object, and then I'm working on the initiality conjecture, which is the main fact which was used to be assumed as being kind of obviously correct, except, of course, that the guy defended a PhD thesis of like 200 pages, proving it in a very simple case. But since then, everybody just ignored it and continued to say that it's obvious that it is true. So that used to be assumed as an obvious thing in the field, and now it's changing. And some other people were beginning to think about how to actually prove it. Thank you.
So,